These were the opening moves to a title Tuesday game on the 30th of January. Magnus Carlsen was playing black, world number one, and his opponent was Cristobal Enrique Villagra. He's from Chile, he's weaker than Magnus, but still very strong, and yet he shouldn't be getting duffed up by h5, h4 on the first couple of moves. But that's what Magnus does. Rattling through here, Magnus goes on to win this game in a stupid number of moves. What was it? 23 moves. I covered this game. Link at the end if you want to watch it. Brutal. And I mention this because today, in this title Tuesday game on April 9th, we see Magnus getting a taste of his own medicine. Revenge is something that Cristobal is after. Because after g3 from Magnus, what does he play here? Pawn to h5. Love it. He's plowing this one down the board here. Is he going to give Magnus the full treatment because Magnus goes knight f3? Are we going to see it? No, we don't. We see d6. Still an aggressive, weird opening, but boo. We wanted that for the fans. But still a great game. Watch out for this one now. e5 on the board. Magnus goes d4, and he's like, come on, play e4 here. Cristobal's like, no, knight d7, bit meek. c4 from Magnus, he's like, come at me, bro, play e4, take the space, damn it. Bishop e7 played, still refused, still Magnus doesn't take. He's insistent and goes pawn h3, and Cristobal's like, fine, I'll take the space if you insist. Where's this knight actually going? It hasn't got great options. Magnus hops forward like this. One absolutely ugly structure he now gives himself, reminiscent of a famous game between Spassky and Fischer, 1972 World Championship. Bobby gives himself the horrible double H pawns with black, and it's a masterpiece. Go away and have a look at that one if you don't know it. Now queen takes, black a pawn up. Obviously, Magnus wants to give his opponent some material, but actually, this is quite playable for white. The center's under fire, and you can't easily cover with the knight, or then we hop with knight b5. Hitting here, no queen b8 to cover, d8, sorry, so you have to come with the king, and your king's getting sidelined, can't castle. So, f5 played instead of the knight development, but this weakens the king, of course. Now knight d5, going after c7, queen d8 to cover the fork. Now h4 from Magnus, a natural structure. He wants to plow boldly forth, do as he got given, and he opens up scope for the bishop on a new diagonal here. So c6, getting ready to kick back that horsey. Does Magnus immediately retreat? Well, no. He leans forward into his mic and whispers, "Tuition to Cristobal." Because he chucks in this one. An in-between move, it means in German. The queen is hit. That one's blocked by the knight, and now Magnus moves the knight back. Look at the dark squared structure. He starts humming, solid as a rock to himself as he goes. Bonus points if you can name the artist of that song. I don't even know it right, but you know, some people will. Old one. Now knight f8. Knight e6 was a threat, so this one covers the square. We see bishop h3 coming on to the more pertinent diagonal. Now queen a5 check, and Cristobal is fighting back. Computer wants king f1, but Magnus goes for a queen trade, loves himself an end game. He's itching to get the ladies off the board, but this helps black. After king f7, sure there were these weaknesses here, but with the queens gone, less dangerous. Rook hg1 from Magnus. Rooks belong on open files, or half open files if no open ones exist. This is a closed structure. Knights tend to be superior in these closed structures. Now we see knight e6 played, and what would you do as white here? Your center's under fire. How many of us are going e3? The most natural move in the world. But you've just created a new kind of structure, and knight g4 now carries extra potency. You know, there's never f3 to kick it anymore. There's no good stuff like that. So Magnus leaves the central pawn. This is so instructive. He goes rook g3. What to do as black? And this is where his opponents just burn time trying to assess positions here. Should you take the pawn? If you do, this is the follow-up move. It's really not obvious stuff at all. If pawn recaptures, you double and you're getting a deadly invasion. Won't go deeper on the line, but that's the idea. And if instead of that, you take with the king, still then you can invade with the rook, but to a new square, and you're pressuring this one twice here. If g6, you can take, of course, with check. There's some problems down the g-file. So the pawn was not touched. Instead, we see takes here. Good move. Bishop recaptures. d6 is hit, and it's not easy to defend that one. So bishop e6 was played. Counter-attacking move, and a good move. Magnus now goes for a double of the rooks, pressuring on g7, covered by this one, and now he does take on d6. But we don't see takes here in response. Otherwise, f5 drops, and that is a critical pawn, holding together the structure. You cannot let it go. So instead, we see the rook come, c5 played, does cement the dark squares for white, but opens the light squares for black. However, once again, we don't see an immediate takes on a2. This one drops, so a6 instead. Ideas of taking in future, but not running into rook a1 and this kind of stuff. So Magnus goes rook g6, and now the knight hops, cutting the communication. You know, if bishop takes, then you're picking up a rook here. So Magnus drops back, now g6. Here Cristobal unlocks dinner for two with Danny Wrench. That's what happens when you get all your pawns on the same color square. What a lad. Now Magnus takes that one, and it makes sense because you want to swap off that bishop, which was staring at a granite pawn structure. The knight had ideas of hopping to d5, and now Magnus can push this p potentially, open the position. But does he first go a3 to take care of this? No, it's so instructive. If you do this, the rook reaches the h-file. Pawn pressured, covered, fine, but then when you push, you know, something like this to make the break, a pair of rooks come off. It's suddenly not so easy to create winning chances, opposite coloured bishops. So Magnus goes bishop e5, covers the h8 square, gives the a2 pawn, but then gets the break in. And the difference here is when the rook recaptures, you're keeping both pairs on the board. You've got some nice invasion threatened, but how about this for an incisive move? Magnus plays after king e6 to cover the f pawn. This move of b3 to trap that bishop out of the game if it doesn't capture the pawn. You know, king, excuse me, king c3 coming. So the pawn is captured, but this is Magnus's idea. He cha-cha slides to the left, the bishop has to go, and he breaks through, opening a second front here. This is fantastic to watch. Just a master at work. Bishop b5, cementing everything. e3 from Magnus. He completes connect 4, wins himself a signed chessboard from Hans Niemann and a day out at the beach. Rook g6 now played, and it's not good here because king c3 comes. Big threats to march in. That's why a5 covers b4. But Magnus doubles the rooks on the 7th, sets up the kebab, and the king's about to get skewered. a4 played here, and Magnus now has checkmate in 3. Test your puzzle rush, because it's not an easy one, actually. Now, maybe you're going to guess the first move here. You know, a check. If in doubt, chuck in a check, right? Or sacrifice your queen. Always sacrifice your queen. Okay, king comes here. What's the follow-up? Because, of course, you want to deliver a check and mate, but it's not check and mate. Rook takes, king wiggles out. So where is the checkmate? It's mate in 2 from this position. So this is why Magnus didn't see it. We've all got all the time in the world, and we can't even see it right. Very well done if you can. You're on your way to Grandmaster if you found this move. Very nice clearance tactic. Now the rook can use this square. What to do as black? There's nothing decent. You know, take the bishop, and this lands a mate in 1. If you want to be really fancy and really just twist the knife, you can give another rook and then land the checkmate and be a rook and a bishop down and a pawn. How about that? The equivalent of a queen. Anyway, all of it missed. So we'll get out from the bat cave there, come back to the game. Magnus goes king b4. Now king d5. Here Cristobal just determined to walk further into the mating net, but actually things not so clear. a3 distracts the king, and this one slithers out of the box. The bar dropping, as you can see. We're back in a level endgame. Rook a7 from Magnus. We soon see a pair of rooks leave the board here. How's Magnus now going to generate winning chances? This one about to invade as well. What's going on? Well, Magnus goes after the backwards pawn at the back of the camel toe pawn formation. This one covers. Now rook f6, and here Cristobal just has to wait. Bishop a4, you know, something of that nature. King b4, blah, blah, blah. But king d5 played. Cristobal just determined to walk into a mating net. Please, Magnus, mate me. It will make my day. Magnus is like, fine. If you insist, I'll checkmate your king. He blocks the escape square here, and there's nothing. Play any move in the world you like. You can't stop it. Rook h6 is going to hold it off for the longest. But okay, f4 played, and bang. Magnus shuts the trap like an alligator on the head of Cristobal. His h5 move here just didn't unfortunately work out, but we got a great game on our hands. Enjoyed that one. I hope you did too. For the epic game that they played first time around and all the details there, have a look at the video on screen, and I hope to see you again soon. Cheers.